Okay, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the 2017 Christabel Pankhurst Lecture. I'm Dr. Hannah Quirk. I'm a lecturer in the law school, and you're very welcome. We have a few people I know are teaching till five, so we may have to slope in late, but we'll make a start. The purpose of this lecture was partly to honour one of our most famous alumna, Christabel Pankhurst, who graduated from this university with a first-class law degree, but as a woman wasn't allowed to practice law at the time. She had quite an extraordinary career. She then turned to activism in the women's suffrage movement. She was jailed on three occasions. She fled to France. She became known as the Queen of the Mob in the tabloid press. And ultimately, after World War I, she was awarded a DBE and became part of the establishment. She's an interesting woman, a complex character, and perhaps not the most famous Pankhurst in her own household. But I think it's important we don't hold people up to unrealistic expectations, or perhaps ourselves. I think one of the greatest lessons of Christabel Pankhurst was she got involved. She had an astonishing intellect, she was passionate, she had commitment, and she had courage. Although Ezra Pound described her as having the intellect of a guinea pig, so treatment of women in public life hasn't always improved over the last 100 years or so. At the International Women's Day last year, we spoke with a councillor, a very young councillor, who had become involved in politics when her skateboard park was being closed, and she lobbied the council to get it reopened. And we were having lots of nice chats about networking and having supportive lunches. And her advice was, you have to get involved. Women need to be involved in politics at every level. That's the only way things start to change. And our speaker this evening, Dame Margaret Hodge, has been involved in politics for the last 40-something years. She's been involved in local politics as a councillor and then leader of Islington Council, and she's been a Member of Parliament for Barking since 1994. She's well-renowned for facing down the challenge of the British National Party in her own constituency, saying, as a daughter of immigrants, it was particularly important to do this. She's held numerous ministerial responsibilities, including equality, education, and employment. Most famous recently for her chairing of the Public Accounts Committee, when she subjected to the representatives from Google, Amazon, and Starbucks to a fairly intensive cross-examination. She has numerous business and board responsibilities, and her book, Called to Account, was published last year. Dame Margaret's going to talk to us for about 45 minutes, and then we'll take some questions afterwards. But would you please join me in welcoming Dame Margaret Hodge.
Right, thank you very much indeed. And I'm really privileged. I was delighted to receive the invitation to do a Pankhurst lecture. And I'm delighted to be with you up here in Manchester today. I was told I could talk about anything I wanted to. So I thought what I'd do is do a quick run through my life and the impact of feminism on it. And where what I think we've achieved through my through that professional and working life, and what where the challenges I think we've still got have still ahead of us. So, I became a feminist actually in the late 60s, and the reason I became a feminist was that I left university. I wasn't a very good student. Managed to walk out of one of my finals, not attend another, did no work, and came up with a third. So I'm not the best of examples to you all, but I got this job in Unilever as as a graduate trainee, and I sort of thought they would take me seriously because they were paying me quite a lot of money for those days. Arrived in the work job to find that the women graduate trainees were allowed to garner the information, but only the men were allowed to write the reports. I thought this was absolutely outrageous. Went to see the head of HR in Unilever, who said to me, if you think that's wrong, leave, because you're not going to get anywhere here. So I did leave, and I went to those very early feminist women consciousness-raising events in London, Sheila Rowbottom and others, and got engaged in feminism. My other funny story is I then went into a research job with an international research bureau, and we were punting for a piece of work, and my boss there rang me up, and it was an important bit of work that they wanted to capture, and said to me, listen, there were two of us doing the presentation, both women, and he said, come in your shortest skirts. This was the late 60s too, so of course I came in trousers. And that also was a spur to my... So I went into feminism because of the discrimination. I accidentally fell into politics. I'd always been an activist. I'd always been on anti-Vietnam marches, anti-apartheid, CND. I was an early member of CND. But when I started having children in 71, in those days, it was much more common for women not to try and balance their work life by trying to work, particularly when the children were under five. And I thought I wanted to be a full-time mum. Discovered after 6 weeks that this wasn't really me, although I went on to have four children and love them dearly, and 11 grandchildren I've got now. So I love families, but it wasn't quite for me. But I was pregnant with my second one, deeply frustrated, member of the Labour Party, and a friend of mine said, go on, Margaret, put yourself up for the council. It'll keep you sane whilst you're changing nappies. So I became a councillor, really, simply because I couldn't do any other work at that time, and the rest is history. And I've thought about trying to put together all my experience over this 40-50 years to see how things have changed. Things have got better, of course they have. But discrimination and inequality is still rife, and the need for feminism, I think, is still urgent. So, for example, when I had my first children, there were no maternity rights. And indeed, a friend of mine, a woman I got to know at Unilever when I was working there, she stuck it out. And she actually went into labor. This must have been 1971, 72. She went into labor in her job because there were no maternity rights in those days, and had the baby and got a phone call from her, from Unilever, saying, you're back in a fortnight or your job has gone. Now, of course, that's got much better. And today you can have a year's maternity rights. You've got 39 weeks of statutory maternity pay, we've got paternity pay introduced, we've got much better childcare, all that has improved. But, and these are all stories from my own family. So my daughter-in-law worked for a private law firm in Leeds. And she was pregnant with her first baby, they wanted her out, they didn't want anybody with children, and they made her an offer. This is only 8 years ago. They made her an offer on the day before she had her baby that she couldn't refuse and basically made her redundant. Another of my daughters worked for, so that's somebody working in the private sector. Another of my daughters worked for one of the London local authorities. They tried to make her redundant when she was off on maternity leave. And a niece of mine worked in the voluntary sector, that's private, public, and now voluntary sector, and she was undergoing IVF treatment, and basically they sacked her because she'd had too much time off having her IVF treatment. So, okay, things have got better from the days when I started having children, but there still is massive discrimination in the labour market. There may be the legal framework, but the practicality is a lot of discrimination in the labour market around women who choose to have children. Or maybe need time to look after elderly parents. That's my first observation. The second one is around local government. So my early time in politics was in local government, and I've got some really funny stories about that. So in 1978, I was pregnant with my third child, and I was in charge of housing in the London Borough of Islington. And I decided to ask for maternity leave. So I went and saw this absolutely petrified leader and said, I want 6 months off to have this baby. And I think I was probably so bolshy. He said, oh, of course you can have this. And gave me my 6 months maternity leave, first time anybody had been elected had had it. I came back after 6 months in the February, March, and found in April, when the elections came for chairs of various committees, that they elected me out of office. They deselected me out of office. But nevertheless, I'd asked for it. I remember being engaged when I was leader of Islington Council, and this goes forward to 82. There were two of us with kids who were, I was the leader and the chair of the Labour group. We were both women with very young children. And we wanted to change the start of our meetings to 7:30 in the evening, because that absolutely key bit allowing you to stay at home to about 7 meant that you could get the little young things actually ready for bed, if not in bed, and then go out to an evening meeting. But of course it meant for the men that there was less time in the pub. So we had a struggle for, I think it took us 2 years to get an agreement that a meeting could only start before 7:30 if there was total consensus around that starting time. A little battle, but an important battle. I was also leader at the time when local authorities were involved in the battles against Margaret Thatcher around rate capping. And I don't know if anybody in here remembers it, or maybe before you were, lots of you were born, but that they were very, you know, local government, it was after the miners' strike, local authorities were trying to take on the Tory government and take on the Thatcher cuts. And actually, it was a campaign which didn't succeed, you know, because it would have, we were being forced, they were capping the amount of money that we could spend, and basically we refused to set a rate, and if you went beyond a certain point, you would then find yourself charged and imprisoned. So it was a bit of a dangerous strategy that we had adopted, rather foolish probably. And of course, one by one, the authorities involved in rate capping caved in. Their groups, people didn't want to put themselves on the wrong side of the law, although they were keen to oppose the Thatcher cuts. And Derek Hatton, famous for his having the year before in Liverpool, got a concession from the Conservative government with a little bit more money, because they'd taken on, was absolutely full of it about how we really had to fight to illegality. And of course, he hadn't done that. And I remember a certain meeting in London where the leader of Southwark came to the meeting and said, we are capitulating tonight, we are going to set a rate. And Derek Hatton started on this great tirade on about how this was letting down the working classes of Southwark and how dare they set a rate. And I was particularly tired that morning. I said, for goodness sake, Derek, cut the crap. That's what you did last year. Which point he turned around to me and he said, Margaret, if it's too hot for you, get back in the kitchen. And then was completely taken aback when the feminists in London reacted to our friend from Militant in Liverpool. But in those years, and particularly from 82 to 92 when I was leader, we actually did a lot of radical things in London politics which were considered loony left at that time, but have been now accepted as sort of total orthodoxy in today's world. So for example, we started monitoring who had access to our services and who we employed on the basis of both race and gender, and that was considered completely off the wall and loony left. We did introduce entitlement to maternity leave for anybody who came to work for the borough, on the basis that nobody would necessarily just come to work in Islington to get pregnant, and of course they didn't, but that was also considered something else, which was completely loony left. And we introduced a first staff nursery. Now, interestingly enough, we modelled that on something that HSBC were doing. But the fact that we used ratepayers' money to establish a staff nursery was considered completely and utterly lunatic, and was we were all over the gutter press, being told off for wasting ratepayers' money. All things which are now accepted orthodoxy today. We did do some mad things in those 80s days. Animal rights activism was quite common in that, and we managed to pass a resolution in Islington Town Hall banning fox hunting off the A1, very effective. And then the one that really got us all over the Sun and the Mail and everything else was that in those days people were actually starting, women were involved in self-defense classes. We were trying to sort of feel safe in the streets at night. and we gave a grant of £500 on a budget of probably, I can't remember, well over £100 million. We gave a grant of £500 to a group of women to buy some mats so that they could carry out self-defense classes, and they happened to be a group of lesbians, so you can imagine the gutter press really had fun with that one. That was all in the 80s. Today, I'm chairing a commission which has been established by the Fawcett Society to look at the position of women in local government. And I don't want to preempt the what we're going to say. We're going to come out with our conclusions in the summer of this year. But we have done a number of sessions with councillors all over the country. And what has come out has been quite disturbing. I thought, you know, 20, 30 years on, things would have moved further. So, for example, we had one seminar in London where a lot of women who are councillors in for the London authorities found that when they got pregnant, they lost their position on the cabinets of their council. That is happening today. No maternity rights at all among the political cohort of people in politics. Interesting enough, the only authority that appears to have a good maternity policy for its elected representatives is Wandsworth, a Conservative council. All the Labour councils are being very discriminatory against women as they have their babies. And we did a session up here in Manchester, and that was pretty disturbing, where there was a lot of, we talked a lot about Devomax and the attempts that are being done on devolution, and there are quite a lot of, if you look at the figures, I can't remember, we're in the high 30s in terms of women councillors on Manchester City Council. You look at the decision makers on Devomax, and it was a deal done behind closed doors by two men, and you look at the picture of everybody who's welcoming Devomax, and I'm not sure there's a woman in that picture. So here we are, me in the 80s, trying to encourage greater equality of in all sorts of ways, not only in councillors and their participation in local government, but also in the sort of agenda that they were setting. And, you know, this is 40 years on, and we're still finding it a very hard road to go along. So that's local government. And then I want to come to Parliament. So I became an MP, and I want to talk about ageism first, really, in women, because I became an MP at the age of 50 in 1994. Now, I chose to wait, and I recognise that, you know, I'm deeply privileged in that my ability to make that choice. I chose, actually, not to go to Westminster before my youngest child. I mean, she was 13 at that point. And I think it's choice that matters. It's not, you know, people will make different judgments and choose to go in at different times in their lives. But the thing I've learned from 1994, which I think is particularly important for women, is that our working lives are not a short sprint, or should not be a short sprint, but they are a long marathon. And that is, when I talk to younger women, I often say that to them, don't feel you've got to do it all by the time you're 30. You have got a long, long life ahead of you in which you can strive to succeed. And ironically for me, professionally, my most successful years have been since 2010, when I was 65. So I became chair of the Public Accounts Committee in 2010. I published my first book last September at the age of 72. And I'm working on which is a book on my years in the Public Accounts Committee. I'm working on my second one, which is on immigration. I've just been appointed to two academic jobs, despite my third degree, at Oxford and at King's, where I'm doing a lot of teaching, but also some very, very interesting research. I founded a new all-party group on responsible taxation, and I've got 11 grandchildren. So for me, those last years, these 5 years, and I've got a lot of energy still, so I'm going to do a lot of stuff in the future. But we are all petrified. Women are petrified of taking time out. Not coming out of the labour market. I think it's really hard if you come out of the labour market to go back in, because you lose so much confidence you lose. But not feeling that you've always got to look up the ladder. There may be times when you've got, particular care and responsibilities when you can not feel you've got to go for the next promotion yesterday rather than wait over the longer life. And it's not just in politics. I mean, there are some wonderful characters that are, for me, role models. I don't know how many of you come across Batty Winkle, 88-year-old, who she's a must be a great-grandmother by now. She's got nearly 3 million followers on Instagram. She lives agelessly. She just doesn't show her age. And she's breaking every taboo in the world about how you act, how you dress, how you should be as an older woman. She's modeled for Smirnoff, and she's also, she's got her own clothing brand. Daphne Self, have you come across her? She's also 88. She's the world's oldest supermodel. She gave up modeling when she was having her children, came back at the age of 69, and regularly appears in Vogue and Harper's. Mary Berry, 81. Wonderful actresses like Judi Dench, Maggie Smith, both in their 80s. Helen Mirren, who only got her first Oscar when she was 61. And in the world of politics, we've got some fantastic feminists who are you know, practicing that thing about it being a marathon. Harriet Harman, Theresa May, even is about to be 60, Angela Merkel. We missed out on Hillary Clinton, but she's still active. Elizabeth Warren in the States, Christine Lagarde, and most recently the appointment of Cressida Dick in London in public life, who has come out of retirement, actually, to go back into taking a top job in public services. And I think one of the things I find very frustrating, there's a lot of being researched and written about older women now. You go to these sort of seminars and events around older women, and what people want to talk about is pensions, care for the elderly in the home, all that social care, all those sort of things. Actually, what we should be talking about is how we enable women to participate in a very active way in the workplace for as long as they are able to. Not just the Dowager Countess in Downton Abbey, but a much more active role. Sorry, I'm now losing my place. I do worry about the cult of youth. And sorry to say this with some of you young people here, but, you know, in so many organizations, we're always looking for new talent. We're always looking for the next generation of people who might emerge. We're looking for emerging youth. Think how often people use that as a phrase. Or we're always looking for ever younger people. We celebrate youth. Now, of course we should celebrate youth, and of course we should encourage innovation and success and ambition and all those things among young people, but not necessarily at the expense of other people participating as well. And I think sort of the older you are, the value of experience, I mean, now in Parliament, I love being often the oldest in the room and being surrounded by young people. It's very, very energizing. But equally, my experience, for example, in fighting militant in the 80s, when we're trying to sort out the Labour Party in 2017, is really invaluable to a lot of people. My experience having brought up four children, my experience both as a local in local government and as a government minister, all of that can add value in the same way that I benefit a lot from the ideas that I get from young people. And it is, I think we should think a lot that if you think about how society is, you know, Botox, facelifts, we're all trying the whole time. I have to admit, I dye my hair. But we're all the time trying to hang on to this concept of youth. And I think culturally, this is a challenge for us all. If we're really to, as we live older, longer, as the world of work changes so that manual work is less sort of tiring for older people, the nature of work changes. All that living longer and the impact of technology means that I think our approach to the world of work and the fact that our lives are marathons, not sprints, become really, really important. Women will never escape from the dilemmas, the conflicts that we face in our working lives. The tension between succeeding at work and working hard and fulfilling the care and responsibilities in the home. And one of my favorite personal stories about this was when just after I'd been elected in, I came in a by-election in 1994, and Tony Blair had just been elected as leader of the Labour Party at that point. And you're seen on television if you sit behind the political leader at Prime Minister's Questions. You will all be watching that little clip of Prime Minister's Questions on the 10 o'clock news every night. So I was absolutely determined that I would sit behind Tony Blair so that the good burghers of Barking would see that I was working really hard on their behalf. And I went in an hour early to bag my place and secured it just behind Tony. And in those days, this was 94, we didn't have mobiles, we were using pagers really to communicate with each other. And I was sitting there and the thing had just started and I was feeling really pleased with myself. And suddenly my pager goes off and it was my 16-year-old daughter who was supposed to be revising for her GCSEs at home, saying, "Panic, ring home." And I thought, crumbs, what's she done? Has she set fire to the house? Is she going to tell me she's pregnant? So I rushed out of the chamber, lost my place, rang up and said, what on earth's wrong, Anna? To which the reply came, "Oh, nothing, Mum. I just wanted to know whether you had your pager on silent." but that was the dilemma between being seen on telly and looking after her. The other odd thing when I look back at the 90s and what we were, women were emerging. We were beginning to, you know, particularly in the Labour Party, we were really actively seeking out women to become candidates and become members of Parliament. But we were really concerned with what we looked at. And we all had to go through this process, which became known as folleting, which meant that what you looked at mattered. Do you remember those sort of those short jackets with power jackets, you know, with endless padding there to make you look really powerful and the appropriate for being a representative of the people? And there was this Barbara Follett, who was a colleague of ours, started a training of people and what became known as folleting them. And I, at that time, I was still at Islington, and the woman who worked with me, who sort of looked after my media profile, said, "You've got to go and get yourself folleted." And I thought this was an incredible waste of time. I didn't wear makeup in those days. I didn't really care what I looked at. And she put such pressure on me. In the end, I said, "Okay, I'll do it." Went off, and it was a whole day being spent looking at yourself, which I was just sort of didn't seem to be the best use of my time. I refused to go at first thing in the morning. You were supposed to be there at 9, but I took my kids to nursery and primary school, and then went off to get folleted, and did spend a day looking at colours, looking at hairdo, looking at makeup and all that. And then the following thing, I came away with all this stuff. I went and spent 70 quid on makeup, which was a lot of money in those days, and particularly for somebody who'd never spent money on makeup. And I went to my hairdresser and said, "Tint me this colour." So she said, "I don't know, it'll suit you." I said, no, I've been colour-coded. Please tint me this colour." So she said, I'll put a rinse in, and if you like it, we'll then take it further. So, and then I was on telly. I was regularly on telly in those days. Didn't tell anybody that I'd bought this expensive makeup and changed my hair. But a number of people came up to me after and said, "Margaret, what have you done yourself? You look so old on telly." So I binned the lot and went back to my old thing. But what that story demonstrated to me was really how insecure we were and how important it was. It's still a case today. Women are always in public life, and certainly in politics, there is always an emphasis on what we look like in a way that there just isn't with men. And if you look at the sketch writers and the way they write up about women parliamentarians, it always criticizes their personal appearance. So a colleague of mine who has a bald patch got that done over by the sketch writers for a little bit of baldness. She's got another colleague of mine who's got a slightly higher pitched voice, got done over for the high pitched voice. Another one, because she had a particularly décolleté dress on one day, that became the focus of the sketch writing. never see it about the men. All they have to do is put a tie on and then they're seen to be respectable. Whereas for women, your appearance is very much commented on and something else that we have to challenge. When I went, and this is all such an interesting stuff and I look back on it, when I went to be selector for my selection meeting in Barking, my predecessor had been a feminist, Jo Richardson, who'd done a lot for women in the Labour Party. But I was the only woman, this was before all women's shortlists, and I was the only woman who put myself forward. And there was a women's section there, so I thought, oh my God, I'll go there and see if I can garner their support for my candidature very nervously. Arrived at this, did my little spiel. My first two questions after I'd done it from Barking was, A, was I in favour of capital punishment? Well, I wasn't. And B, was I in favour of cutting immigration? Well, I wasn't. So I had this rather tense exchange with the women's section, but still got their support. When I then came to the bigger group of members, and we were all being interviewed as to whether or not we were the appropriate candidate, I was the only one asked about my childcare facilities. None of the men were asked how they looked after their children. And I then arrived in the House of Commons. 1994, I was the 165th woman ever to have been elected as a Member of Parliament in the UK. When I was first there, there were more male MPs whose first name was John than there were female MPs across the whole of the House of Commons. Today, we're about a third, and in most of those come from Labour, where we're running at about 40% of other elected representatives are women. And the only reason that has happened is that we have taken the positive action and had all women's shortlist. And I know it's controversial, but if you actually look at what happens in all these selection battles, where you don't have an all women's shortlist, invariably in the Labour Party, they select a man. And of course, among the Conservatives, they're getting a bit better, but until they actually introduce, I think, a positive action mechanism, they will never get women in. And I have to say to you, as I look at the younger generation of women, many of whom I spend my time mentoring, we've got some fantastically capable, talented experts with good experience coming in as women members of Parliament through that route. If we didn't do it, we wouldn't get it. If we look internationally at women, it's quite shocking that Britain lies 47th in the international league on the percentage of representatives who are women. And top of the list is Rwanda, where over 60% of the members of parliament are women, then followed by Bolivia, Cuba, and the Seychelles. Although one has to be a bit suspicious of this, I went and did some work with VSO in Nepal a couple of years ago around women's representation and also violence against women. And they have a 50% sort of quota for women. And when I talked to them, I had one evening with them, I talked to one woman and I said, asked her which political party she belonged to. And she said, oh, well, I've joined X party, because of course that's the party my husband belongs to. So it's not, the statistics of themselves don't tell the whole story. When I arrived at the House of Commons, there were not enough women's loos, hardly any. There was certainly none in the bit where you vote. The only arn and arning board was in the women's lavatory. There were none in the men's toilets. We still have pink ribbons on our coat hangers, on which we are supposed to hang our swords. And we have all the sketch writers taking advantage of us. By 1997, there were over 100 Labour women, 120 in all. And my experience under the Labour government, when I was really privileged to be a minister for most of those years, was all we really did make a difference. We worked together as women in that Labour administration, and you would not have had the advances in childcare that we've had so far. We wouldn't have had a national childcare strategy. There's a lot of work to do. The quality of childcare and the cost of it is ridiculously low. and I, as the first children's minister, I spent a lot of time on that. You wouldn't have had Short Start if there hadn't been women there. My only sadness about that was I used to remember going around the country in those days saying, this is the new frontier of the welfare state. What I didn't realise was that it was so fragile that it could be so readily dismantled when people wanted to cut public expenditure. I remember a really interesting battle when tax credits were first introduced, and a bunch of us had to really go and bully Gordon Brown so that the money didn't go, as we called it, into the wallets, i.e. into the men's income, but actually went into the purse, went into the women's, was added to the women's income. And probably our most successful and most difficult battle was around flexible working, which I think is probably the change that has had the best impact on our ability to balance our lives between care and between work. And neither Gordon Brown nor Tony Blair wanted to introduce flexible working, the right to request flexible working, because they thought that it would be upset all the businesses' interests, and it would be business was hostile to it, as indeed they were to the minimum wage, if you think back on it. So really, it was a bunch of us being completely persistent, women, working together, women who were advising Blair in Downing Street and Brown in the Treasury, and just by total persistence and never letting go of it, we introduced that right to flexible working. And of course, what has been shown is that, you know, over 90% of cases, people request it and are granted it, and it allows women to contribute properly, and it benefits the organisations in which they're working. But equally, there were things that we tried to do that we haven't managed to change. So my best example of this was, I was a culture minister at one point in the Department for Culture, Media and Sport. And I arrived there, and we were responsible for the appointments to all the major museums and orchestras and theatres. And only 26% of those appointments went to women. Now, if there's, you know, there's absolutely no reason whatsoever that we couldn't have had parity there in the appointments between men and women. So I set about trying to do this. Faced huge opposition from the officials, who kept telling me what I was doing was illegal. But all we were doing was putting forward a lot of the talented women that were around to go on shortlists. And what I said to the chairs of the various boards was, if you don't put a woman I might be minded to turn down your appointment. And that little pressure worked. And within a year, we'd got it up to about 46%. We nearly got to 50%. I then had to take a year out because my husband was terminally ill. When I came back after that year, I found that we'd gone back from the 46% down to the 26% within a year. So although I'd managed the achievement in a year, but without actually consistent total commitment to ensuring equality there, the thing had dissolved. The other interesting observation I have on my life in the House of Commons is how important it is to actually for women to rise above party politics and to cooperate across the House. And we do a lot of that. So Justin Greening, who may not be everybody's cup of tea, but when she was first a Treasury Minister, she managed her first questions without looking at a note. It was a really brilliant performance. And just going over to her and saying, well done, which I did, I think just boosted her confidence and made her feel secure that as a woman she could in a Treasury team perform as well as many of the men. And when people like Caroline, there was a time when Cameron sacked a whole lot of women, Caroline Spellman was one to go, and again just a bit of solidarity, gender solidarity, I thought was really is really important and helps us get changes in the hours of the House, all those little things that we wanted to do. And I think women do make a difference in politics for all sorts of reasons. The way we network, the way we are consensual and always look for collaboration, and we actually work in different ways from the men. And I want to just finally talk about two examples from my recent work to illustrate that. One comes from the battle that we had in Barking against the BNP. In 2006, the BNP got 12 seats on the local authority. and they were all, and they got every seat they stood for. If they'd stood 52 councillors, they'd 52 candidates, they would have got 52 seats. And they were then, from 2006, they were working towards getting their first Member of Parliament in 2010. And the reason that they were successful, well, it's quite a complicated story, but immigration was an issue. When I arrived in Barking in 94, I came from inner London, got out of the tube at Barking, and inner London was multiracial, you know, as Manchester is. Got out at Barking, it was completely white. And if you look at the census data in 1991, over 93% of Barking residents were white. 20 years on, so it's not a long period, that had reduced to just over 58%. So there was a massive shift in the nature of the demography of the population in the borough. That was really because of right to buy. So Barking had been a huge council estate built to house the Ford's workers, really. That was how it had started, and well over 90% council housing. Right to buy led to the privatisation of that housing. And as it was privatised, either it was sold on to second-generation immigrants who were trying to get their first step on the housing ownership ladder. And Barking is still the most inexpensive part of London, so that's where they could afford to buy. Or people bought their house, moved out, and let. So they bought to let. And in letting, they tended to let to inner London councils, who then housed their homeless families, where there was a preponderance of people from ethnic minorities there. And then once you start getting, I mean, the first community I noticed coming in were the Kosovans, and of course you get a few there, and that then becomes an attraction for other refugees and asylum seekers who are coming in. So that was what had happened. Ford's at the same time, which at its top was employing over 50,000 people, now employs less than 4,000. So a lot of those industrial jobs had gone. And in the old days, Ford's used to literally go around the schools when they were in year 10 and recruit the young people to come into well-unionized, well-paid jobs, so they never had to get educational qualifications because it didn't help them with their career. So low educational qualifications, but very solid industrial jobs. When those disappeared, that created tensions. And the Labour Party was very inward-looking. We were used to weighing votes in. We cared more about what happened in those days' smoke-filled rooms than nobody ever bothered to talk to the good citizens who had the vote in Barking and Dagenham. So with all that, I thought, if we don't change our politics, if we don't change what we do, we will lose this seat. It's a bit like Scotland. I always think if the Scots had actually, those Labour in Scotland had changed how they approached their work, we wouldn't have, the Labour Party wouldn't have been annihilated there as we were in the election. And I think I did this because I'm a woman. I really think my feminism came at it. So everything I do now is based on the principle, does it help me to reconnect with my voters? So I don't go to Labour Party meetings more than I have to. I don't go and to sort of cut ribbons at town hall shindigs. Everything I do has to pass that reconnection test. And I reconnect in various ways. It'll be through street meetings, through door-to-door canvassing, through campaigns, and through one activity, which is our coffee afternoons, and just talk about those. So I'll ask 1,000 people, voters, to come and have a cup of tea with me. Probably about 70 or 80 show up. They get a decent cup of tea and coffee and a chocolate biscuit, and we sit them on small tables, and then I go around table to table. And I don't talk about whatever's been going on in the Westminster bubble that week, and don't take the campaign that I'm told to take by the Labour Party, whether it's sort of anti-cuts here or whatever. I just listen to what people want to talk about. And people's politics starts from the local. It starts from what's happening around their own community. So it is things like dustbins or a bit of antisocial behaviour or prostitution or the sighting of a bus stop or those sort of things they talk about. But they will talk about national issues that impact on them locally. So I will get immigration, and I will get housing, and I might get benefit cuts, those sort of things. But the important thing is the agenda is being set by what they say. And after I've gone round and they've all talked to me, had a chance to chat to me, we then come together, And we start, and I always start on the local issue. So I'll just give you an example of one particularly hard coffee afternoon we had. It was, so I got them together, and we said, and I said, okay, there's clearly a problem about the rat run. And this woman, started talking about the rat run, and this woman who's white, who's in her sort of 50s, got up and started screaming at me, Margaret, you've let this borough go to rack and ruin. It's absolutely chock-a-block of all these immigrants. It's just not how it used to be. I can't get an appointment at the hospital, and they're all benefit scroungers. And she sat down. I thought, we're in for a heavy afternoon. And then actually a white man got up in his late 50s and said, I've been on benefits all my life, for 25 years. I'm desperate to go back to work. I always run out of money at the end of the month. I'm not a benefit scrounger, and sat down. And then a Jamaican man got up, probably also late 50s, early 60s, and said, I've been here since the 50s. I've brought my two girls up here. I've always paid my taxes. I'm British. And he sat down. And then I had a couple of people who are BNP, probably now UKIP, who one of them said, my boy's just come out of the army, he can't get a house because you're giving it to all these Albanians. And the other one, a similar sort of remark, which I challenged. And at the end of it all, I thought, I must go back to the original, after we'd broken up, must go back to the woman who raised the temperature in this meeting and see she's okay. Went up to her and said, is everything all right? And she said, I do want to talk to you, Margaret, but I want to go and apologize to those two men first. And that's the sort of powerful, different way of doing politics. And it's all about sort of really listening, acting where I can. I never did anything around, wouldn't do anything about immigration numbers because I don't believe one should do. But I never did anything about housing, which was their other big issue, where I would have liked to be able to deliver. Never did anything about, but I listened, I acted where I could, so I would act on the rat run and sort that out, communicating with them, so I was always writing letters back, thanking them for coming to the coffee afternoon, all that sort of stuff. But a very, very, very different way of doing politics. And through that, I rebuilt trust between the Labour Party, the elected representatives, and we saw off the BNP. And I'm absolutely convinced that if my Scottish colleagues had done likewise, but that's not the way of the macho male politicians that come out of Scotland, things would have been different. The final thing is the chair of the PAC, and I will shut up because I've been going on too long. I'm the first woman ever to have chaired this committee, Public Accounts Committee. It's the oldest committee in Parliament. It's been going for over 150 years, and it's always been chaired by a man. And I'm also the first person ever to be elected to the job. In the old days, the post was in the gift of the leader of the political parties or the whips. Since 2010, we've had elections, and you have to be elected by all your colleagues, so not just Labour colleagues, all the MPs in Parliament. In 2010, I'd just seen off Nick Griffin in Barking, the BNP in Barking. My husband had just died, so I was pretty exhausted. I had 2 weeks in which to campaign for all this thing. And the only thing I always think got me the job was I went to every woman MP and said, I'm a woman, just vote for me. And luckily, they did. I've got this stunning, when I had the job, you have a stunning room, which is on the upper committee corridor in the House of Commons, overlooking the Thames, and down one wall is a picture of all my the past incumbents of the job, all men. And I discovered there'd been more assassinations of chairs of Public Accounts Committee than they had. So I'm waiting for Google to have a pop at me. I also discovered that there'd been more chairs of the Public Accounts Committee who'd been in prison than in anything. And they were all Labour MPs, but then I discovered why. One had gone to prison because he was a pacifist, another one was a conscientious objector, and the third actually was a supporter of the suffragette movement, so they'd gone to prison for good reason. In 1861, when the committee was founded, its budget was £69 million. That's what it had, following the taxpayer's pound, was £69 million, which in today's money is about £8 billion. Today's budget is getting on. It's about £770 billion. So following the taxpayers' pound in that is huge. In 1861, and actually right the way through, the committee only met for a few weeks in the year and produced one report on value for money for public expenditure. We managed to produce in our 5 years 246 unanimous reports from our committee. And the committee reflects Parliament, so it has a majority of Conservatives on it. So getting them all to agree on what I hope think you'll agree was often very, very critical reports, I think again, was something that you could only achieve if you're a consensual politician, building actually that unanimity, not trying to stand rather often petty principles and avoiding failing to meet the big picture. I think that, you know, it was down to us, and we did do. I mean, if you think of some of the stuff we did right across the piece, it was important. We didn't have great powers. It's always petrified me. The only thing is we could invite people to come and give evidence to us. And if they didn't accept our kind invitation, I'd then send them a letter on a piece of 8-4 saying, you are required to attend. And had to do that a few times. And then I was always a bit worried of what would happen if they just ignored the bit of A4. And apparently my ultimate sanction, which I never had to do, was that they could be incarcerated for a period of reflection in the clock tower under Big Ben. The reports were not all bad reports, although those tended to be the ones that got the publicity. But if you try and get publicity for good reports, you just don't manage it. So I always recall this issue of, we did a report on 16 to 18-year-olds in education. And it was, and the Today programme rings me up and said, will I come on the next morning to talk about it? And I said, fine. And the researcher said, what are you going to say? So I said, I'm going to say, this is quite a good service. These are the areas where we look for improvement. But actually, we endorse the work that they're doing. So the researcher said to me, but I thought you were going to be critical. So I said, no, it's a positive report. So she said, well, I better go away and read it. And she went away and read it and came back and dropped me as an item on the agenda. We uncovered tumultuous waste, and it was quite interesting. The worst was probably in defence procurement. And I always remember that when the officials came to see us about this, they could never look me in the eye, because after all, I was only a woman, and how could I understand anything about defence equipment and defence procurement? Of course, I worked really hard to make sure that I was totally on top of it. And we were effective at raising the debate on particularly tax avoidance, and that's one of the issues that I'm taking forward. We've raised the debate, but we haven't yet actually got a fair and just system of taxation where you're treated equally, whether you're rich or poor, whether you're a big corporation or you're a small and medium-sized enterprise. But what I learned from this, and I'll stop now, is really that every change in one's life brings new opportunities. And really, the challenge, I think, for women is to grasp those opportunities with all the energy, vigour and commitment that you can. And I think, actually, it is a man who does influence, the words he said influence my approach to my life, and it's Martin Luther King who said, and endorses my view of life, is our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter, and the things I do, I think, really matter. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was an absolute tour de force and fascinating and very inspiring. We've got a few minutes for questions, so you could hang on for the microphones and we'll pass them around.
Thank you, dear Margaret. It was absolutely fascinating, really enjoyable. Thank you for coming along. You made the point that the Tories have a way to go before they have the number of women MPs that they might have. And yet they've had two women prime ministers. Is it not time that the Labour Party had a woman leader, and are you up for it?
I think it's shocking we haven't had a woman leader. And what I would say is there's loads of absolute, there really are a lot of very, very, very talented women who I think could do the job brilliantly. And I think, I mean, just in this, if we had Harriet Harman around this time, I think we would be in a much, much better position to oppose around Brexit and around all the absolutely appalling cuts and changes that are being made in our public infrastructure and social infrastructure. So, of course, we should have a woman. It's completely ridiculous that we haven't got there. I don't think me. I think I'm far too controversial. I'm far too Marmite of a politician.
Yes, thank you very much, Dame Margaret. Thoroughly enjoyable. I have followed your career with a huge degree of interest since I came to the UK then. This is a brilliant opportunity and I really, really enjoyed it. I'm interested in learning your views about select committees because towards the end of your presentation, you basically said that we didn't have many powers. And those of us who study constitutional law, we always think select committees are quite powerless. But obviously, the impression that you gave in the public sphere is that for at least finally we had a select committee that was really having an important influence and it was really viewed as a very powerful force in our society. Was that because of your very engaging personality or it was because the system has changed since 2010, as you were saying, or a combination of both?
Fingers crossed, it was the beginning of a process of change. I think the fact that we were elected from 2010 onwards, people are now elected to the post, makes a huge difference because it gives you autonomy and authority and allows you really to leave your tribal party loyalties at the committee door. And I think that's been a terrifically important change. That's the first thing. The second thing is, I think if you look at, there's some very good select committees now. Think of the work that was done around British Home Stores, you know, for example, or think of the work of the Health Select Committee now, or think of the work. There's a lot of powerful work being done. And what I hope is that what we started doing, my generation, the 2010 generation, you know, the ones that got it in 2010 when we had the elections, is to show there is an alternative career in politics. You don't actually just have to climb the greasy pole to ministerial preferment to fulfill actually changing the world or representing your constituents. And ironically, although I was a minister through all those Blair Brown years, bar one, I've probably changed the world more as chair of the select committee than I did in all those years as a minister. And I think there's a beginning of a recognition. Whether that will be sustained over time, we'll have to see. But I'm just hoping that they have. And formal powers, we have a lot of discussion about do we need more powers, all those sort of stuff. I do think it was jolly hard work. It was 5 years when it was 24/7. Just because you have to be, I always felt I had to be more on top of the subjects than the people we were interrogating. Otherwise, you could not be effective. And that meant you just had to do the work. We're not well supported in the UK. The select committee system, there are five people who administer the committee, but we meet twice a week. We produce reports. We've got to get witnesses. So that was purely an administrative job. We had no... we did not have any research support. We had the National Audit Office, but they are auditors, and we had to bring the sort of politics, the view of the citizen on value for money there. And in America, our equivalent committee has 200 full-time researchers. But when we went to look at it, I sort of came away thinking, I'm not sure that's the right answer, because they have... 40%, I can't remember the figures. It was about, some working to the minority party, more working to the majority party. So the whole thing becomes much more partisan. Whereas because in a sense we were dependent on our own capability, we managed to build that cross-party coalition where people did leave their crude party politics at the committee door. And when I think back on why did we do well, I mean, I think there are a number of things. The we were dependent a lot on investigative journalists. I think I'm the only MP who's got a good word to say about journalism, but they were really, really important to us. We were very dependent on whistleblowers, and we did a lot of work around that. They, you know, I think that the protection of whistleblowers has still got a long, long way to go before we can give people that confidence to come forward. And we were dependent on those organisations that supported people, in particular the voluntary sector, working with people in particular areas. You know, I changed the way we worked, so we often heard the view of the client or the citizen or the consumer, however you want to call it, before we talked about it. So there were various things that we changed. Will it sustain itself over time? Time will tell.
Hello. Hiya, my name is Julia Horn. I've got two questions to ask you that are a bit strange, so I'm sorry. Are you aware of the NHS charge for migrants, which is about £250 per person? It's a supplement for people who've come from different places. They're getting charged over and above any tax that they pay. And the question is, if you are aware of it, do you know what budget it goes into, where that money goes? It's paid per family member. So people who are from different countries have to pay for their NHS services. The second question is about Theresa May attempting to create a hostile environment, and she made a speech saying that she wanted to create a hostile environment for migrants and refugees, and I wondered if you were aware of that and what you thought of it.
Big topic. So my next book is going to be around immigration and integration and changing communities based on my experience in Barking and Dagenham, and we've just completed 100 qualitative in-depth interviews with people in the constituency from all backgrounds. So I've done a lot of thinking about these issues. It ties in the xenophobia and racism that is now a feature of British society is very, very frightening. It's not unique to Britain. It's, you know, occurring. You can see it with Trump, you can see it with Le Pen, you can see it in Holland, you can see it probably in Italy. So it's something that is emerging across the world, and it comes out of people's frustration. This is why the reconnection work that I did, I think, was so important. People's frustration that they feel anger at the establishment for not responding to their needs and their aspirations. That is there. I also think that politicians have to take a lot of the blame, because politicians didn't talk about immigration for a long, long time. When I first talked about it, I was accused by members in my party of speaking the language, of giving the oxygen of publicity to the BNP, and speaking the language of the BNP because I wanted to talk about the issues. And I think that was, you know, we will only ever win the argument about the benefits and the importance of migration if we do it through democratic processes, not by refusing to engage in the debate. And I also think, so politicians have been wrong about that. We were wrong not to talk about immigration, pretend it wasn't happening. And the other thing, and there is more immigration, because migration is now a feature of globalization, so in the same way as capital crosses borders, so do people. The other thing that we're so wrong about is promising numbers. So when people talk about it, our only response is to talk about numbers. And we never deliver on numbers because people will move cross borders. So, you know, we will find even post-Brexit, probably that immigration figures will continue to rise because of this, the global impact, the impact of globalization on migration. So having said all that, I think it's then really important to listen to why people get angry about immigration. And in Barking and Dagenham, what comes up time and time again is this issue of fairness, that people want to feel that you're treated fairly. So if you're somebody who's recently arrived here, and this is not an asylum seeker or a refugee, but if you're somebody who comes in as an economic migrant, it just offends people's sense of fairness if they feel that you can jump a housing queue, there isn't enough housing, you're always going to have to distribute limited public resources. If you can jump the housing queue because your need is greater, although you may have lived in the borough for less. And I think we have to recognise that feeling of fair. We have to recognise and respond to it. And I think if you do respond to that, you actually burst that bubble of racism, which is how easily that sort of anger at unfairness becomes translated into people's politics. So I think we've got to start talking about how, particularly where you're talking about rationing public services, which a lot of services are, we've got to start thinking about how we can stop saying we're going to control the numbers, but start thinking about rules and conventions that reflect fairness in that distribution and rationing of public services. And I don't have a problem with saying, actually, before you can access public housing, if you come here as an economic migrant, not a refugee, not an asylum seeker, an economic migrant, you have to spend a bit of time in the borough, in the area in which you live, before you can be allocated council house, competing with people who've waited for generations to get their house. Of course, we need to build more housing, but you're still going to have a process of rationing. And to come in a long way around to your question on health, and I think the same thing goes for there. I don't think I have a problem if people come here as economic migrants in saying, or maybe we should think about it anyway, that you spend a bit of time actually putting in to your society before you are eligible to take out. So there may be a time when you're first here that you should be seen as contributing financially to the NHS, which is always going to be rationing a finite amount of money to people before you have that same right to take out of it. I know that's controversial, and that's why I say it's a big subject, but I think there is something in that argument that we need to at least consider and talk about. Sorry, that's okay.
One last question.
Thank you very much, Margaret. It's absolutely inspiring. But I also, you mentioning racism and xenophobia. From my perspective, I've been here for more than 30 years.
More than
30 years.
Yeah.
Racism and xenophobia have never been far away. And what I have found that life is made difficult for us non-white who want to contribute in public life, because to compete against a white candidate, the white candidate then uses the race card against me. And it is very, this is something that has come across all my life. And I think very few politicians have actually had the courage to stand up and not fall into that trap and that weakness. And I think this is something that needs to be addressed as Britain is moving forward. If Parliament is not going to remain a sea of black people, of white people, and a few token ones who got there because of they've been appointed, so to speak.
Yeah, I agree with that. And one of the most depressing features of the whole of the Brexit debate and the aftermath of the vote is that this isn't about really Europe. This is all about a xenophobic rejection of the other. And we failed, all of us. We failed as part of the establishment to convince people. And what is interesting embarking now is the sort of conversation I talked to you about is less likely to happen today because they think they've won. So they think they've got their country back. And that somehow, magically, barking is going to become as white as it was in the 1980s once we exit from Europe. And that's so interesting. One of the scary, for me, elements of this whole thing is that once we do exit from Europe and people find that it hasn't changed the nature of the demography in the UK, what happens then in terms of the confidence in politicians and the political class? That is scary.
Well, thank you very much for
a
sad note to end on, but I think overall the talk has been enormously thought-provoking and inspiring. I'm very conscious that when my grandmothers were born, they weren't entitled to vote, and that they had to leave school when they were 12, that they had no control over their economic or reproductive or property rights. And in many ways, we are enormously privileged to be living at the time we are. But I think the last year has shown in particular that we can't take any of this for granted. We have a female prime minister, but we also have a week in which Parliament was debating whether women should be made to wear high heel shoes at work or not. So there is, you know, we have come a long way, and I think the whole purpose of this lecture is to demonstrate how far we've come, but not to be complacent. I was particularly interested in your comments about the need for coalitions and working together. And Christabel Pankhurst's father was an enormously important figure in the suffrage movement and in legislative change and supporting the women in his family campaigning for the right to vote. So I think it is important that we do focus on some of these issues. I have to say a few thank yous as part of the team effort. This whole lecture series was Professor Margot Brazier's idea, who has been a mentor to me and I'm sure many of the women and others in this room. Caroline Hoyle's been huge helpful organizing, and Jackie Horrocks, and obviously we'd like to thank the Law School for their support with the event as well. We have a little thank you for you.
Oh God, you shouldn't have bothered with that.
Absolutely, no, it's been great. So if we could all join and thank our speaker today, Margaret Hodge, and take this forward.